Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to CEC Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in this session, we are going to start with our new series on cell biology. This is the first lecture, and today's lecture, we are going to discuss what nucleus is, as well as we would be covering what nucleolus as well as biogenesis of rRNA is. And for this discussion, we have once again with us in our studios Dr. Charu Dogra Rawat. Dr. Charu Dogra Rawat is Assistant Professor in Department of Zoology, Ramjas College, University of Delhi. Dear friends, if you want to ask questions from Dr. Charu Dogra Rawat on the particular topic, then do call us through our toll-free number. Our toll-free number is 1-800-110-430. Friends, I request a number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. You are requested to call in the last 10 minutes of the lecture so that the lecture goes uninterrupted. Now, let's welcome our guest, Dr. Charu Dogra Rawat, and let's try to have deep insight into the topic. Hello, ma'am. Welcome to the lecture.
Hello. As you said, today we'll be starting with cell biology. Cell biology is the study of the cell, which is the smallest unit of a biological life. So we'll talk about in the series this: what is a cell, what are the constituents of the cell, how the functioning of the cell takes place, and how the different systems are coordinated so that the cell can function properly. Today we'll be starting with the nucleus, which is the central part of the cell, and we'll be talking about its structure, its function, the organization of the chromatin inside the nucleus, and then we'll move on to talk about the subcellular compartments of the nucleus, also primarily the nucleolus. So a cell is a complex structure with its investing membrane, nucleus, and nucleolus. When Charles Darwin said that, he meant it about the eukaryotic cells. The basic difference between a prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell is the presence of a very well-defined nucleus. So as we all know that prokaryotic means a primitive and karyon means the nucleus. So primitive nucleus is there where a well-defined nuclear structure is not present in the prokaryotic cells such as bacteria, etc. And the genome is lying in the cytoplasm itself. However, eukaryotic, eu means new and karyon means nucleus. So in eukaryotic cells, there is a predefined nucleus, which is a very well-defined, you know, it's a compartmental structure. There is a envelope which is surrounding this nucleus, and it encloses the genome of the cell, which coordinates all the functions inside the cells by making the proteins which are required by the different systems. So the prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells, the complexity differs, and this difference, as Charles Darwin suggested, is due to the presence of this investing membranes, nucleus and nucleolus structures like those which are very complex. So the absence or presence of well-defined nucleus differentiate between the prokaryotic and the eukaryotic cell. Let's have a little historical perspective into the discovery of the nucleus and how it was, the functions were known. So Robert Brown was the first person who used this term nucleus in 1831 for the opaque spots which he had observed while studying the epidermis of orchids. So he just when he viewed it under a microscope or a primitively microscope at that time, he observed these spot-like structures and he named them as nucleus. Sooner he identified nucleus as a common feature in all plant and animal cells. Then O. Hertwig reported for the first time the presence of a nuclear membrane. So he defined that nucleus is in fact an entity and separated by rest of the interior of the cytoplasm by this nuclear envelope which is present. Strasburger in 1882 proved that nucleus arises from pre-existing nucleus by division. Now, as we will see, that an important function of nucleus is that it encloses the genome. The genome which codes for different proteins that carry out all the functions of a cell. So this cell division also, you know, the genetic material is divided into the progeny, and Strasburger was the first person to observe that in fact the nucleus divides and it exists and are passed on to the next generation and along with the genetic content material which is duplicated. Hertwig and Van Beneden showed the role of nucleus in fertilization. So we'll talk about this in developmental biology, that when the sperm and egg fuse together, their nuclei fuse together because the mixing of the genetic content needs to take place. So this particular function of the nucleus was observed by Hertwig and Van Beneden. Hammerling in 1953, by his grafting experiments on acetabularia, which is the largest unicellular green marine alga, proved the role of nucleus in heredity, growth and morphology. As we will see, that nucleus is the central hub in a cell where different processes take place that ultimately leads to the functioning of a cell properly. And many of the functions, such as the heredity, which is the passing of genetic information from the organism to its progeny, the growth of the cell as well as the structural aspects of the cell is maintained by the nucleus. And this was observed by Hammerling in 1953. So basically, as Delhi is to India, the nucleus is to a cell. So since the central part where all the where the headquarters are basically residing, and it controls the entire working of the cell. Of course, there are state governments, etc., which at the state level also coordinates and work for the different states which are present in India. But still, the central part is the Delhi. Similarly, the nucleus is the compartment in a cell which carries out and which looks after the functioning of the entire cell. The different compartments, some of the compartments such as mitochondria are semi-autonomous. They do function by their own also, but in a dependent manner. But they do function like that. But the central control is basically present in the nucleus where the genome is residing. So what Delhi, the capital city, is to India is what nucleus is to the cell. So looking at the different functions of nucleus, it stores the genetic information in form of the DNA, and this is called as the chromatin. So the genetic information present in the DNA, which is passed on from the next one generation to next generation, is enclosed in the nuclei in the form of chromatin. This chromatin, when undergoes cell division, takes different forms, and we will be discussing briefly about how the organization of this chromatin changes when the cell divides. Another function of the nuclei is that during the cell division, this chromatin is arranged into chromosomes in the nuclei, duplicated and distributed among the daughter cells. So this is an implication of the hereditary role which the nuclei plays. So the information is replicated and then passed on to the next generation. And before doing that, the structural difference occurs and the chromatin converts into a chromosome. Then it regulates all the cell activity. As I said, because the DNA is residing inside the nuclei, the DNA contains different genes, and genes give rise to different proteins. These proteins carry out various functions which are going in the cell. So basically, and moreover, these functions are regulated because, you know, depending upon certain stimuli or certain conditions in which the cell finds itself, the activity or the transcription or basically the protein production can be switched on or switched off. And this regulation, the first level of regulation is when the DNA forms the RNA. And DNA is residing inside the nuclei. Therefore, the nucleus basically regulates all the cell activity which is going inside the cell. mRNAs, the process synthesis of mRNA, which is called as a transcription, is done in the nucleus. These carry the genetic information from DNA in the nucleus to cytoplasm, where the message is then translated to proteins. So the origin of the central dogma, so as to say, is basically the nuclei, where the DNA is converted, the DNA information is coded into mRNA, which then goes out into the cytoplasm and various proteins are formed. And as I said, again, the proteins are the effector molecules which will regulate the cell activity as a whole. Then the ribosomes are synthesized in the nucleolus, which are then transported to the cytoplasm. Now, ribosomes are organelles which are involved in the formation of proteins from the mRNA. So, these ribosomes are synthesized in special compartments of the nucleus, which is called as nucleolus, about which again we'll talk in detail. And then they are often transported into the cytoplasm, where the translation process can take place. So, looking at the structural organization of nucleus, the nucleus has a nuclear envelope. This nuclear envelope is a highly regulated membrane barrier that separates nucleus from the cytoplasm and provides the structural framework of the nucleus. Now, this statement tells us about two different aspects of the nucleus. One, that it is giving rise to the structural framework, or basically the sanctity of the nucleus is because of this nuclear envelope. And second, when it said that it is a highly regulated membrane barrier. So whatever things are crossing from inside to the outside or outside the nucleus into the nuclei is basically done in a regulated fashion. And it's not, you know, the diffusion can take place, but there are specialized structure from where a regulated transport can take place. So it's a regulated, it's basically again telling us about the functional aspect of the nucleus, which is very important. So it is a regulated membrane barrier that separates it from the cytoplasm, as well as it gives the structural framework to the nucleus. Now, nuclear envelope is a double membrane structure. It has got an inner nuclear membrane and an outer nuclear membrane that are continuous with another organelles, which are called as the endoplasmic reticulum. So in cell biology, we talk about all these different organelles which reside in the cell, as I have started with the central organelle, the nucleus, and then there are mitochondria, there are endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi complex, and there are different organelles which work in a very coordinated manner. So the outer membrane of the nucleus is actually it's continuous with the endoplasmic reticulum, which resides just outside into it. And obviously, all these arrangement is functionally related manner. So you have got this outer membrane, there is an inner membrane, and there is a smooth endoplasmic reticulum, which is continuous, and then there is a rough endoplasmic reticulum. Again, when we will discuss about rough and smooth endoplasmic reticulum, we will see that rough endoplasmic reticulum had ribosomes sitting on its membrane, and smooth endoplasmic reticulum are not associated with the ribosomes. Now, the space between these two nuclear membranes is termed as the perinuclear space, and the outer nuclear membrane and inner nuclear membrane are fused together at numerous tiny holes called as the nuclear pores, or nuclear pore complexes that perforate nuclear envelope. So, nuclear envelope is not like an insulator which is separating the nucleus and cytoplasm, but it does allow regulated transport of the materials from inside to outside or from outside to inside. And this regulated membrane structures are termed as the nuclear pore complexes or nuclear pores. So, looking at the structure of nuclear pore complex is an extremely large structure with a diameter of about 120 nanometers, a central transport channel 90 nanometers in diameter, and an estimated molecular mass of approximately 125 million Daltons. Nuclear pore structure is a structure with eightfold symmetry organized around a large central channel. So, as you can see in the diagrams, there is a large central channel which is there, which is the central transporter through which the substances can pass in and out. And then there is an eightfold symmetry. There are two different types of proteins which are there, the cytoplasmic ring and the nuclear ring, then having different kind of filaments around. So, the detailed structure of nuclear pore complex consists of four separate structural elements. First is the scaffold that constitutes the cytoplasmic ring, the nucleoplasmic ring, and a central ring of thick spokes. Now, each ring has, as shown, eightfold symmetry. The spokes are connected at their inner edge and support a central hub. Interspersed between spokes are aqueous channels, which is for the passive diffusion. So, this is the structure of the scaffold, as you can see in the diagram, which keeps the nuclear pore complex in its shape. Then the central hub or the transporter is the actual channel from where the potential the transport of the materials takes place. Its structure consists of two irises of 8 arms each. Central 90 angstrom channel is present. The radial arms extend into the luminal space and connect to the pore scaffold. So that is the basically transporter or the central hub protein. Then apart from that, there are short thick filaments attached to the cytoplasmic side of the pore, which are called as cytoplasmic filaments. These are the staging area for nuclear proteins to be bound before transport. So the proteins or the molecules which need to be transported inside the nuclei are first bound at these central filaments. They are kept in place and then they pass through the transporter into the inside. So these filaments actually hold the molecules before transporting them across the nuclear pore complex. Then towards the nuclear side, you have got a basket which is attached to the nucleoplasmic side of the pore. It consists of 8 filaments extended from the NR to a smaller ring. So you can see that these are the basket region which is underlying or towards the nucleoplasmic side which is present. So these 4 separate structural elements make the nuclear pore complex, which keep the complex intact as well as allow the transportation of molecules, mostly from the cytoplasmic cell to the side to the nucleoplasmic side, but also the vice versa transport. Apart from these nuclear pores, the nucleus has nuclear lamina. Now, using EM Fawcett, he was the first one, using electron micrography, the Fawcett was the scientist who first described the nuclear lamina or vertebrate cells as a fibrous structure underlying the inner nuclear membrane. So nuclear lamina is kind of a matrix which is present inside the nucleus. As you can again see, there are, that is a double membrane structure. Then there are nuclear pore complexes which is present. And then inside there is the nucleoplasm or the matrix of the nucleus which is there. And then there are regions which is termed as the nuclear lamina. These nuclear lamina is composed of proteins which are called as laminins, which are also present in the nuclear interior, and lamin associated proteins. So you can see here that these are the nuclear matrix region which is there. These are the nuclear pore complexes, and you know, this is the nuclear pore complexes, and this entire protein molecule is the lamina. Then there are certain proteins which spans the inner membrane or outer membrane, etc. But this nuclear lamina lies just adjacent to the inner nuclear membrane which is there. Nuclear lamina is an essential component of a metazoan cell. It is involved in most nuclear activities, including DNA replication. So initially, when nuclear lamina was discovered, it was mainly associated with giving the structural rigidity to the nuclear membranes. So lamina or laminin proteins were basically defined as the structural role. But gradually, all the activities, nuclear activities, were related to these laminar proteins or lamina, such as the DNA replication, the RNA transcription, nuclear and chromatin organization, cell cycle regulation, cell development and differentiation, nuclear migration, and as well as apoptosis or the programmed cell death which occurs. So nuclear lamina has a variety of role to play apart from the structural rigidity which it is providing to the double membrane nuclear envelope which is there. Now, lamins, the proteins which form the nuclear lamina, are type 4 intermediate filament proteins which have a short N-terminal head domain, a long alpha helical coiled coil rod domain, and a globular tail domain which is there. 3 lamin genes encode these 7 alternatively spliced forms. There is LMNA gene. A-type lamins such as A, AA10, C and C2 are all derived from this LMNA gene. B-type lamins are encoded by B1, such as B1 are encoded by LMNB1 gene. B2, B3 lamins are encoded by LMNB2 gene. So 3 lamin genes are basically found in the which codes for these new lamin proteins which are there. So you can see all these proteins, these 3 genes, due to the alternative splicing or different spliced isoforms, they give rise to 7 different proteins. Lemmings were originally proposed to support the nuclear envelope and provide the anchorage sites for chromatin. They are now shown to be involved in a number of other functions, including the nuclear envelope assembly, DNA synthesis, transcription, and apoptosis. So initially, when nuclear lemmings were defined, they were basically a rigid framework for the nuclear envelope to remain its place. And moreover, the genetic content which was present inside the nucleus was supposed to be attached at this nuclear lamina. So initially, this was the only function which the nuclear lamina was defined for, but now we know that nuclear lamina is associated with all the different activities that the nuclear cell has to take, nuclear cells conducts. So this is a list of nuclear envelope proteins which is there. So there are nuclear pore complexes. They contain all these different kinds of proteins which are there. Then inner nuclear membrane has another set of proteins which are found there. Outer nuclear membrane has different receptors or the nesperine, etc. And lamina constitutes these four type of proteins. So nuclear envelope proteins, there is a list which is shown on the screen. Nucleoporins or pore complex proteins are termed as the nucleoporins or NUPs. And as you can see, there are a variety of nucleoporins which are involved in the formation of the nuclear protein complexes. And then nuclear transmembrane proteins or NETs are basically found in the inner nuclear membrane. Now we go on to look at the chromatin organization inside the nucleus. An important aspect of nucleus is that it encloses the DNA material, and this DNA material is passed on from the generation to generation, carries all the genetic information and plays a role in the heredity part. So this, how is the chromatin organized inside the nucleus, constitutes an important aspect of studying the nucleus. So briefly, we will go through the overview of this nuclear organization. So there is an entire, there is a double helical structure DNA which is there. Then there is a 10 nanometer structure when the DNA is actually swirled around the core proteins, which are called as the nucleosome. Then this is again looped up on itself to form the 30 nanometer chromatin fiber. Then these chromatin fibers, which are on each other, then are thrown into different loops, and these loops then further into loops, and then they condense to form the metaphase chromosome structure. So this hierarchy is actually during the cell division also. Such a type of arrangement is found in the interface nuclei when the chromatin is lying freely and, you know, the cell is not dividing. When the cell starts to divide, the chromatin tends to condense and take the formation of this chromosome. They tend to formation of this condensed structure called as the chromosome. So nucleosomes, just quickly we'll go through the overview of how the chromatin is organized. The nucleosomes, they are the building blocks of chromosomes. The basic structural unit is the chromatin, the thread of the DNA. The nucleosome was described by Roger Kornberg in 1874. And this is how it looks like. So this drum is the histone core which is there, and this entire region, this drum and the swirled around or the looped around DNA is basically called as the nucleosome. This is the core DNA which is revolved around the nucleosome, and this is the linker DNA which then connects it to the next nucleosome which is there. This nucleosomal structure was found by digesting the DNA with nucleosomal, with micrococcal nucleases, which keeps on degrading the free DNA, and finally a 200 base pair unit was left which could not be digested because that DNA was actually swirled around the or wrapped around the histone core protein complex. Now, histones are the major proteins of the chromatin. They are small positively charged proteins containing a high proportion of basic amino acids such as arginine and lysine that facilitate binding to the negatively charged DNA molecules. Five major types of histones are there: H1, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. H2A, H2B, H3 and H4, the dimers and the tetramers, form the core protein, and H1 is basically formation of the linker protein which is there. So the different properties of these proteins are given in the table. These core histones, are they share a common structural fold. There is an N-terminal tail. There is a histone fold which is present. The histone fold comprises of the three alpha helical regions separated by two short unstructured loops that mediate the formation of the head-to-tail heterodimers. So there is an H2A, H2B dimer and H3, H4 tetramer which is there, giving rise to the octet of this core protein complex which is there. Then this core protein complex gets associated with the H1 protein, which is said to be the linker histone protein which is there. So chromatosome is another term which is used, which is the extension of DNA to 166 base pair length and the addition of linker histone H1 give rise to what is called as the chromatosome. So you can see this is the histone octamer and this is the DNA which is wrapped around it. But if you add the histone H1 and then the extended DNA, then that forms the chromatosome. So in here the 146 base pair DNA or 1.8 superhelical turns are there, and in there is a 166 base pair or 2 superhelical turns around the nucleosome is found. The role of H1 protein is to stabilize the point at which DNA enters and leaves the nucleosomal core, and the C tail of H1 basically stabilizes the DNA between the nucleosomal core which is there. So packaging of the DNA with histone yields a chromatin fiber approximately 10 nanometers in diameter that is composed of the chromatosome separated by linker DNA segments. Packaging of DNA into 10 nanometer chromatin fiber gives a 6-fold condensation. Now further, this is a higher order structure when this nucleosomal 10 nanometer fiber actually wraps around itself. It's a left-handed helix, 6 nucleotides per turn H1 and histone N-terminal tail stabilizes, and this is a 30 nanometer fiber structure that occurs because of the interaction between the adjacent nucleosomes which are there. The chromatin fibers are most likely flexible and dynamic, and they might interchange between the different folded states. And the factors on which this different folded states depend upon are the presence of other chromosomal non-histone proteins, the modification state of core histones and linker histones, the position of the linker histone to the nucleosome, and intranucleosomal spacing which is there. Now packaging into the 30 nanometer fiber gives a 40-fold condensation which is present. So further organization or further condensation leads to the formation of a further higher order structure in which this 30 nanometer fiber chromatin is now thrown into loops. So these loops are attached to the lamina at the base, which is called as a nuclear scaffold. So organized into loops of up to 100 kb that are held together at their bases by a proteinaceous substance called as the nuclear fold. So this is a nuclear fold, and then these are the loops which are there. So 30 nanometer fiber is actually thrown into such kind of loops. Two classes of proteins contribute to the nuclear scaffold, which is the topoisomerase 2 and structural maintenance proteins, which are called as the SMC proteins. A model for the structure of an interface chromosome basically states that interface chromosome is folded into a series of loop domains, each containing about 20,000 to 100,000 nucleotide pairs. Individual loops can decondense, that cell require direct access to the DNA packaged in these loops. Decondensation is brought about by the enzymes that directly modify the chromatin structure as well as the protein such as RNA polymerase. The folded 30 nanometer fiber is anchored to the chromosomal axis, and the base of the chromosomal loops is rich in DNA topoisomerases, which are enzymes that allows the DNA to swivel when anchored. So this is how an interface chromatin looks like, where the 30 nanometer fiber is thrown into the loops. So features of the interface chromosome, the chromosome at the interface again have two different kinds of structures depending upon the condensation and decondensation of the chromatin, which is basically the heterochromatin and the euchromatin structure. So heterochromatin is a more condensed form of DNA, whereas euchromatin is the less decondensed form of DNA. So that is how the chromatin is, or the interface organization of the chromatin is there inside the nucleus. So the different activity is also associated with the structural part, because as we will see, heterochromatin implies that it is less active region and euchromatin implies that it is more active region. So that is the organization of chromatin in the interface nucleus which we see. Thank you. an important functional aspect of nucleus is that it contains or it encloses the chromatin, the genetic material of the cell, which passes this information from generation to generation, and the cell basically works on the information contained inside the in this particular chromatin which is there. Now, interphase nucleus or a non-defining nucleus contains this structure, this genetic content in the form of loosely arranged thread of DNA, which we saw that is wrapped around the protein complexes and forms the structure called as nucleosomes. These nucleosomal 10 nanometer fiber structure then further condense over itself to form the 30 nanometer fiber structure. This 30 nanometer fiber structure is then thrown into loops, and that forms the interphase chromatin how it looks like. Now, the activity division, regional division is also present in the nuclei, which differentiate between a more condensed and a less condensed chromatin defined as the heterochromatin and the euchromatin region. So, we can see that the early replicating chromatin, which is labeled with the nucleotide and shown in red here, consists mostly of this euchromatic region or the less condensed region of the chromatin. Together with the late replicating chromatin labeled 3 hours later with tagged replication protein and shown in green, comprising mostly the constitutive heterochromatin centers. This spatial and temporal program of replication is followed at every cell cycle. So, there is a division in the activity based upon the condensation also. So, the ones which are euchromatin divides, replicates early, whereas the heterochromatic nature region replicates lately. So, this is basically showing how the cell, inside the cell, this chromatin replication takes place, and there is a temporal and spatial differentiation. Now, talking about the spatial differentiation, the chromosomes actually occupy specific regions of a nucleus called chromosomal territories. When the cell divides, this condensation of chromatin takes place. So, the chromatin, which was loosely bound just as a 10 nanometer strike, condensed to so much, thousands of fold condensation takes place to form into structures what are called as chromosomes. So, these chromosomes are then divided and, divided amongst the progeny and then give rise to the two cells. Now, looking at the interphase nuclei, about the organization of these chromosomes, when the tagging was done, it was found that they are not intermingled amongst each other. They actually, the different chromosomes which are going to be formed in the metaphase stage are actually occupying separate discrete territories in the interphase nuclei also. So, that is also a very important aspect of nucleus, how it coordinates all the activity is that the organization of chromatin right at the non-dividing stage is also such that the chromosomal part, which is going to be condensed into separate chromosomes, they occupy different territories. So, there is a spatial arrangement which is present in the nucleus, and they are not just randomly intermingled amongst each other. So, this the figure actually shows the stained diploid spread of chicken metaphase chromosomes. The same spread is shown after multicolored fish with pseudo-colored chromosomes which are there. The probes were detected using antibodies. So, if these are basically the metaphase chromosomes which are there, and different chromosomes are tagged by different fluorescent antibodies. If the interphase nuclei are tagged by the similar kind of antibodies, you can actually see that they are not lying randomly, but the chromosomes which are going to be formed in the metaphase at the interphase also are occupying specific territories which are there. So, chromosome number 2 and chromosome number 2, the diploid cell, are basically occupying these regions. These are the regions for chromosome number 1, 4, 6 and so on and so forth. So, the chromosomal territorial organization is very important at the time of the nucleus, which gives its defined function of at the time of division, which is there. This again shows the in situ hybridization with biotinylated human genomic DNA of a Chinese hamster into human hybrid cell line carrying a single X chromosome reveals the specifically labeled human chromosome in metaphase, spreads, and its respective human X territory in the interphase. So, this is at the metaphase, and this is the X chromosome which is formed, but this is the interphase nuclei, and you can see that this X chromosome is actually present in this particular territory, and not that different parts are located at different places of the interphase nuclei which is there. So, this visualization is also seen in this particular metaphase surface plate that after fluorescent in situ hybridization using labeled chromosome painting probes is there. A single light optical midsection through the nucleus of a human lymphoblastoid cell after 3D fish with the same painting probes showed that this particular HSA19CT in the nuclear center and HSA18CT at the periphery. So these things are again showing the regional occupancy at the time of the interface nuclei. So this concept of chromosomal territories is very important in the interface nucleus, the how the organization occurs. So looking at the metaphase chromosomes, the highest form of condensation that occurs, so it has got a typical structure. There is a centromere, there are sister chromatids. This is called as the primary constriction. There is a secondary constriction also which is there. So there's a telomere, centromere. So these are all different parts of the chromosomes which are there. And as you can see, the different regions are highly condensed, called as the heterochromatin, or less condensed, which are euchromatic region. Centromeres are the constitutive heterochromatic regions, and then they have got these arms which are called as the sister chromatid. And if you look at it, then inside there is a nuclear matrix where these loops of 30 nanometer fibers are present as far as the organization is concerned. So centromere is the part which was described by Walter Fleming, and based upon the presence of centromere, it can be divided into metacentric, submetacentric, acrocentric, or telocentric chromosomes depending upon the location of the centromere, which is there. They contain repetitive DNA and modified nucleosomes. The centromere protein CENPA and CENPB are inner centromere proteins that interact directly with DNA. So these are the properties of two different proteins which are there, and the CENPB protein contains repeats of 175 base pairs in length which are called as alphoid, and in humans there are basically 1500 to 30,000 copies of the alphoid DNA per chromosomes are present. So centromere is a region of specialized chromatin found within each constricted chromosome that provides the foundation of another protein structure called as the kinetochore assembly. So kinetochore is the protein assembly around the centromere where the spindle fibers attach at the time of cell division and divides these sister chromatins and takes them into different poles which are there. These kinetochores comprise of 80 or more proteins, and their function involves the microtubules which basically cause this separation into the two different poles. Other proteins are part of the spindle checkpoint that allows only cells with correctly assembled spindles to pass into the inner phase. Centromere identity is preserved during cell division. However, kinetochores are dynamic structures. They are formed only when the cell needs to, or at the metaphase, anaphase stage, when the spindle fiber needs to attach, and they used to go to the different poles during the cell cycle, which is there. Now, centromere serves as a site of sister chromatid attachment. A chromatid one half of two identical copies of the replicated chromosomes, which is there. So attachment of the chromosome or sister chromatid is mediated by the cohesin complex of proteins which is there. So you can see these are different stages of meiosis in which it is there. This is a chromoneme which is present, and then these chromonemes constitute together and condense together to give rise to the arms of the chromosome which is present at the time of metaphase which is there. The end of the chromosomes are termed as telomeres. These telomeres, they protect the ends of the DNA molecule contained within the chromosome from attack by exonuclease enzymes and repair enzymes. The telomere contains special DNA sequences. They are made up of hundreds of copies of short sequences which are G-rich, and they contribute the 3' end of the DNA molecule extend for up to 200 nucleotide beyond the terminus, giving a single-stranded overhang which is there. So this is how the structure of telomere looks like. And this is very important that nucleosomes are not present in the telomeric region of chromosomes. However, two special proteins, TRF1 and TRF2, are present. TRF1 regulate the length of the telomere, and TRF2 maintains the single-strand extension. The single strand extension is important for the formation of loop, which is called as the T-loop, which aids in the replication of the telomeric structure. So the formation of T-loops requires both telomeric repeats and the single stranded G-tail, and this is how the telomeric replication takes place. We talk about the details of this during the molecular biology sessions, in which we talk about the replication of DNA and see how the telomeres are replicated. So you can refer to the lectures related to the replication in the molecular biology series. The telomeres tend to shorten in the cells without telomerase over time, and cells may stop dividing and become senescent, and the telomeres shorten below a critical length. So this special type of replication that occurs helps to maintain the telomeres of same length so that chromosomes do not keep on shortening after each cell division and does not undergo senescence because of this shortening of the telomeres which is there. Apart from the primary constriction, which is termed as the centromere, there is a secondary constriction which is also present in the chromosomes. There are one or more secondary constrictions that can be found. The primary secondary constriction, termed as the nucleolar organizing region or NOR, is necessary for the formation of another structure inside the nucleus called as the nucleolus. Now, nucleolus appears at the end of one of the end of the chromosome. A part beyond that is called as the satellite, and the chromosome is termed as the sat chromosome. Now, human chromosome number 13, 14, 15, 21 and 22 contains these NOR regions, and these NOR regions contain several hundred copies of gene coding for ribosomal RNA. So, you can see this is a chromosome and this is a chromosomal arm. There is a centromere which is present, but this is a secondary constriction which is there. This secondary constriction is termed as a nucleolar organizer regions. So, all these chromosomes, nucleolar organizer region, will lie in one region and will give rise to the nucleolus around it. This particular region is rich in the repeated rRNA genes, and these repeated rRNA genes, when we talk about the biogenesis of ribosomal RNAs, then has a look of something like this, where different coding sequences are present interspersed by the intergenic spacers that finally give rise to the mRNA and codes for these 18S, 5.8S or 26S ribosomal proteins which are found in the eukaryotic cells which is there. The DNA region which is beyond this nucleolar organizer region is termed as the satellite, and such a chromosome 13, 14, 15, 21 and 22 are termed as the sat chromosome which is there. Apart from these, there are other secondary constrictions that may also be present, but their location is usually constant for a particular chromosome, like it is present in the long arm of chromosome number 1, 10, 13, 16 and the sex chromosome Y. The primary secondary constriction, which is the primarily the secondary constriction, is the nucleolar organizer region which we have talked about. Now, coming to the nucleus, so that was a functional aspect of nucleus. The major functional aspect of nucleus and the associated or the underlying chromatin material which leads to the function of the nucleus. And that chromatin material, how it is organized in the nucleus, which we have talked about. Apart from that, there is a subcompartmentalization in the nucleus which is also there. So, apart from the region which is called as the nucleolus, there are different compartments within the nucleus which are present. They are non-membrane bound structures. The localization of most nuclear processes is done at distinct regions. So, they include, the nucleus includes the nuclear envelope which is basically surrounding the nucleus. The confinement of individual chromosomes to certain regions of the nucleus into chromosomal territories. So, they also give rise to different, so chromosomal territories are like subcompartments which are there, but they are non-membrane bound, but they are localized into certain specific regions which are present. The nucleolus is the site of the ribosome subunit biogenesis. Then apart from that, there are further subcellular compartments such as Kajal bodies, the promyelocytic leukemia or the PML nuclear bodies, and SC35 domains which are called as the speckles, which represent mobile particles involved in RNA processing, transcriptional regulation and apoptosis which are there. Then apart from these compartments, there are sites where the assembly of active RNA polymerases 2 takes place, and these are termed as transcription factories or transcription hubs. Then there are DNA replication or replication factories or DNA repair complexes. So, all these are actually defined inside the nucleus into various compartments. These compartments are non-membrane bound, so they are diffusible into each other, But there is a regional specification. So there will be a region where there will be transcription going on. These are called as transcription hubs. There are regions from where the replication machinery will be lying. These are called as the replication factories. There will be Kajal bodies, PML bodies, speckles, and other such. And all of them will be enclosed inside the nuclear envelope which is there. So this particular figure represents all these subcompartmentalization within the nucleus. The Kajal bodies contain protein coiling and are enriched in small RNPs. They function as sites of RNP or ribonucleoprotein assembly and processing. So you can see this is the double nuclear envelope. These are the nuclear pore complexes which are there. But there are transcription hubs, replication hubs. These are the Kajal bodies which are present. These are speckles. These are paraspeckles which are there. This is a perinucleolar component. So this is a nucleus and this is a nucleolus which is present. Then there are PML bodies which are there. And there are different kinds of. So this is the lamina where the genome content is attached. So nuclear envelope, there is nucleolus, there is speckles, Kajal bodies, PML bodies, and these are the centromeres which are basically tagged in this particular box which it is showing. PML bodies, the function is that it interacts with the chromatin. They are the sites of accumulation of transcription factors and chromatin modifying enzymes. So a major role of the DNA present inside inside the nucleus is to transcribe into RNA that will go out into the cytoplasm and give rise to the proteins. So this transcription involves a lot of protein factors which are there, which are called as the transcriptional factors. So PML bodies are the sites where these transcriptional factors are accumulated and they interact with the chromatin. And then various chromatin modifying proteins, because the regulation of the function of the DNA, a major mechanism by which it is done is by modifying the chromatin structure. This comes under the epigenetics, where the information is not enclosed in the sequence of the DNA, but the structure of the DNA. So this structural organization of the DNA contains the chromatin modifying enzymes, which can modify this particular structure and hence cause the regulation of the various activities of the which can regulate the activities of the nucleus by regulating the expression of the genes present on the DNA, which is there. So this particular picture tells about the law and order that is maintained in the nucleus, again emphasizing the fact that in the nucleus, all the functions are basically defined in different regions of the nucleus which is there. So this is the envelope, this is the nuclear envelope and lamina which is shown. So these are again, you know, these are the splicing of the mRNA. This is that hub where the splicing is taking place. This is that hub where basically the biogenesis of the ribosomes takes place. So this is the nucleoli which is there. You can see the Kajal bodies. You can see the different kinds of translation, transcription which is taking place here, or the modification of the RNA that is transcribed. So polyadenylation, capping, everything is happening in here. Then this is the replication hub where the replication will start. So in different, in nucleus, there are regional localization based upon the different functions that are occurring, and therefore localization of these particular proteins which are there. So apart from the spatial organization, we have also talked about the temporal organization, where we say we have seen that the early replicating or the late replicating DNA, the euchromatin or the heterochromatin, is also locally organized inside the nucleus in a particular fashion which is there. So the nucleus maintains inside it the law and order which constitutes or which makes the functions of the nucleus run very smoothly, which is there. So coming to talk about the detailed structure and function of nucleolus. Nucleolus is organized, as we have discussed, around the chromosomal regions that contain the genes for 5.8S, 18S and 28S ribosomal RNAs. So ribosomes are the organelles which contains three different types of ribosomal RNAs in eukaryotic system. And this 5.8S, we will talk about this detail when we talk about ribosomes. But this basically, S is the sedimentation coefficient, and based upon the differences in the sedimentation coefficient of the ribosomal RNAs, they are categorized or classified into different types. So there is a 5.8S, 18S and 28S rRNA, apart from the 5S rRNA which is present inside the eukaryotic system which is there. This ribosomal RNA then outside in the cytoplasm gets associated with various ribosomal nucleoproteins and forms what are called as the ribosomes. These ribosomal subunits then assemble onto the messenger RNA and causes the translation or the formation of the proteins to take place by decoding the information that is contained in the mRNA. They contain, nucleolus contains relatively little chromosomal DNA but is rich in protein and ribonucleoprotein complexes. So, secondary constriction which we have talked about or the nucleolar organizer region is necessary for the formation of nucleolus that appears at the end of the one chromosome, a part beyond which is called as satellite. And as we have seen in humans, chromosome number 13, 14, 15, 21 and 22 contain this nucleolar organizer regions containing hundreds of copies of genes containing genes which are coding for the ribosomal rRNA. Ultrastructure of the nucleus looks something like this, that there are three subcompartments that has been identified. The three subcompartments include fibrillar centers which are surrounded by dense fibrillar components, and the FC-DFC complexes are embedded in the granular component. So, you can see here this is the granular component, this is the fibrillar center, and then this is the dense fibrillar center which is present. So, this is the ultrastructure of the nucleolus as seen in the EM. Each have distinct protein composition and functions. So, we will see the functions of different structures of different substructures present in the inside the nucleus by looking at the the biogenesis or the formation of the ribosomal RNA which is there. Now, ribosomal RNA synthesis or the ribosome biogenesis, of which ribosomal RNA is an important part, is a vectorial process which may be envisaged as an assembly line beginning in the fibrillar part, that is the FC and DFC, and continuing into the surrounding granular portion. So, how does this biogenesis takes place? Fibrillar part represent the sites of the nucleolar location of the ribosomal genes and or the rDNA as it is termed as. And this rDNA is the organizing center for the pole 1 transcriptional process. The product of transcription is the pre-rRNA, which is the initial material from which ribosomes are generated. So, ribosomal genes are located, the region of DNA is termed as the rDNA. There are multiple ribosomal genes which are present in tandem at that particular regions. And this particular region structurally is located in the fibrillar part of the nucleolus which is there. This pre-rRNA which is transcribed initially accumulates in the DFC region, the dense fibrillar component, and its first processing steps takes place in this region. So, different rRNA molecules are first transcribed into a single rRNA which is termed as the pre-rRNA molecule. The pre-ribosomal particles then move to the granular component and then to the nucleoplasm before being finally exported into the cytoplasm through the nuclear pores. So, you can see this is the nucleolus which is there. So, this pre-rRNA synthesis or early rRNA processing events occur at this particular region. This is the depot of the inactive rRNA genes which are present. These are the late rRNA processing events or the assembly of ribosomal particles where it takes place. So, FC and DFC region, and this is the granular component which is present. So, this is how the localization of the subcellular compartment or subnucleolar compartments looks like in relation to its function in the biogenesis of the ribosomal RNA that takes place. Now, in eukaryotes, there are two subunits of ribosomes which are present. The smaller subunits is the 40S subunit of the cytoplasmic contain a single 18S rRNA. So, ribosomes are basically ribonucleoprotein complexes. So, it contains a ribosomal RNA as well as a lot of proteins which are associated with it. So, 40S subunit is associated with 18S rRNA and 30 to 50 ribosomal proteins that are associated with this RNA. While the larger subunit, which is termed as the 60S subunit, contains at least three distinct rRNA components, the 5S, the 5.8S and the 25S rRNAs, as well as again 40 to 50 proteins which are there. So these ribosomal RNAs, all but the 5S rRNA, are transcribed as a single large precursor called as the pre-rRNA from tandemly arranged rDNA transcriptional units. So this is the rDNA, and ribosomal DNA contains tandem repeats of ribosomal rRNA genes which are present. The 5S rRNA is transcribed independently as a 3' end extended precursor by the RNA polymerase 3. So RNA polymerase 1 transcribes the 3 RNAs, which is the 5.8S, 25S and 18S rRNA in eukaryotes. The RNA polymerase 3 transcribes 5S rRNA separately, and RNA polymerase 2 transcribes most of the protein coding genes which are there. So we are also talking about that RNA polymerase 1 transcribes the 3 ribosomal RNA genes into a single rRNA initially, which is termed as the pre-rRNA, which is there. After processing, the mature 5S rRNA molecule is imported into the nucleolus and as a ribonucleoprotein complex, which is there. So organization of the rRNA genes, let's have a look at it in a deeper manner. So these are the tandem repeats which are present. Looking at one of the repeats, there is a transcribed segment of 13.7 kb which is present that contain the genes for 18S, 5.8S and 28S. In between, there are internal transcribed spacers, and there are external transcribed spacers which are outside it. So these green portions shows the external transcribed spacers, red portions depicts the internal transcribed spacers, then there is an external non-transcribed spacer also which is present. So this is how basically the arrangement of the ribosomal rRNA gene looks like. The pre-rRNA transcripts, the mature of rRNA sequences, are separated by at least 2 internal transcribed spacers termed as the ITS1 and ITS2, and are flanked by 2 external transcribed spacers shown in green here, termed as 5' ETS and 3' ETS. So ITS1, ITS2, 5' ETS and 3' ETS, and these are the genes that are transcribed. So these are 2 internal transcribed spacers, but they will be removed at the time of splicing, when these particular genes are then formed from, or these particular RNAs are formed from the pre-rRNA which is there. An important structure by which active rRNA looks like is such a structure which is termed as the Christmas tree, as seen in the electron micrographs of isolated and highly loosened chromatin spreads. Ribosomal DNA axis engaged with many pole 1 molecules and the attached nascent RNA transcript can be seen. Terminal lobes that can be seen here on the nascent rRNA correspond to the rRNA processing complexes. So this is the rRNA DNA genes which is there, and because there are tandem repeats which are present, they are transcribed. So there are a lot of RNA polymerase complexes which are there, and they are transcribed. So there is a larger one and shorter. So it gives rise to a Christmas tree kind of a look. So this is the growing RNA transcripts which is there, and this is the RNA polymerase molecule. So this is the axis of ribosomal DNA which is present, and these are the growing rRNA chains which look something like this, which is present. The pre-rRNA is modified covalently and cut into the mature RNA complex. So this is the pre-rRNA containing the region of 3, the coding region for these 3 ribosomal RNAs, as we said, interspersed by the spacers. These are the ITS and these are the ETS. So the splicing will take place, giving rise to the mature rRNAs, which are individual, the 18S, the 5.8S or the 28S RNA which is there. So pre-rRNA is then transcribed into this form, and this pre-rRNA is then the nucleoli contain a large number of small nucleolar RNAs that function in this rRNA processing. After the processing, these individual RNA molecules are go out of the nucleus, from the nuclear pore complex, associate with the proteins, the ribosomal proteins. So in fact, these ribosomal proteins go inside and they associate with the 16S, 5.8S molecules, and these subunits then come outside. Then these 2 assemble onto the messenger RNA for translation process. A better picture again. So ribosomal DNA is transcribed into a single pre-rRNA, which is a 45S rRNA precursor. Then their processing will take place inside the nucleus. They will form such a kind of different types of rRNA which are there. They goes out of the nucleus. They associate with the ribosomal proteins, forming 40S and 60S subunits, and this will go outside and associate with the rRNA, causing the protein synthesis. So an important aspect of nucleus, so functional aspect of nucleolus is explained, as well as the biogenesis of the ribosomal RNA is explained in this particular session.
With this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much for giving us a productive session. And dear friends, if you want to give your feedback for this lecture, then do write to us at info.cec@nic.in. We are going to upload this lecture on YouTube soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you once again.